It was a dark and stormy night. I always thought that would be a really good way to start telling a story. And I've heard a lot of stories as people have come and gone through my ear over the years. They're walking along the weary road looking for somewhere to rest themselves, and then the next morning, they're up and they're off again. Well, this one night, this one story I'll never forget. See, I don't think anybody will ever forget. Okay, so, it wasn't really stormy, but it was dark. And out of the darkness came this young couple, this soon-to-be family of three. They weren't lost, but they were a little bit desperate. Which is funny because, you know, these days people seem to be the opposite. They're not desperate, but they are lost. They just don't realize it yet. And this has really been a problem ever since. People going through the season looking for a light to light their path. But what I didn't realize was on that night, the light was coming to me. God was making a way through my stable. God was making a way to bring a light to the hearts of us all.
Yeah. everybody. Welcome to this Christmas Eve 2016. I hope your day has been great, and we're looking forward to a great night together. And so welcome to Lakeview Heights Baptist Church. If you're a guest of ours, it's so good to welcome you here, and we're going to have a great evening together. Just a little note for those of you who have children who are with you tonight. We do have a nursery that is available for kids up to about 2.5 years of age. And so throughout the performance tonight, if you'd like to avail yourself to that, you're more than welcome to do so. Tonight, as our innkeeper already kind of shared with us, we're going to be sort of going back in time and discovering this awesome story of what this night is all about. And so as you take in the music and the story, the true-to-life story of what God has done to prepare a way for us, we hope that your heart is touched and that God does something really amazing in you tonight. Because this is not just any other night. This is an important night where God touches lives. Would you bow in a word of prayer with me, please? God, we thank you for bringing us safely to this place tonight. We thank you for every person who is here. We pray, God, that you would impress upon them that you have made a way for them to be in a relationship with you, oh God. And so thank you that you came for a purpose, for a real reason. And Lord, that you came for each of us. And so, God, we thank you for this Christmas time. And we thank you for this night. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Would you stand together and wish the people around you a Merry Christmas tonight as we come into this place and share this time.
Yeah.
After all the commotion of the day, it finally settled down. And in this quiet moment, I'm amazed at the things that have gone on here today. Welcome to my humble inn. I own this place. I wouldn't believe it to see it. The things that have gone on here would amaze and astonish you. Most of the things seem like visitors at an inn. Who knew? But more than that, the way that God has pulled all these pieces together to culminate here in my inn, well, it's nothing but a miracle. I can't believe I almost missed it. What do I mean? Well, earlier tonight, the little couple showed up. We're all booked up, sorry. Please, we don't need much. What do you think I meant by booked up?
We've been walking for days, please.
You think you're the only people that have been walking for days?
No, it's just that.
You think you're the first people banging on my door this late at night?
Sir, there has to be something. A closet, perhaps. Anything.
Listen, you can keep asking, but the answer's gonna be...
Mary, what are you doing? You need to rest now. Please, let me handle this.
Are you...
pregnant? Yes. Very much so.
And when do you expect the baby?
Any day now.
We won't be in any trouble, I promise.
I've told you, there's no room.
I'll pay you anything you ask.
There's nothing I can do.
It's okay. God will provide.
Hey, wait a minute. Just give me a moment. I'll think of something.
Christ the Savior is born.
I almost missed it. You see, we're in the middle of a census. The government made everybody go back to their own hometown. The government. They're always after money. Our money. But this wasn't bad for me, because Bethlehem was packed. And so was my inn. I had no idea that now such things would come about. And it wasn't just a baby. I mean, it was a baby, but not just any baby. My inn was full. But people kept coming. Shepherds without sheep. They left their sheep on the hillside. These shepherds came, and they told me that they were looking for a baby in the book. Well, I thought it was coincidence. That's all he told me what the angels had said in the field that night. And even more peculiar was that he would announce to these, the lowliest of caretakers, the arrival of Emmanuel. That's peculiar indeed.
Joseph! Can't you build a decent fire? Joseph! Fire went out again. Come on, light. Light! Light!
Oh my God! I am trying!
Wait!
Do not be afraid.
Ah, don't be afraid. You don't be afraid of me. I'll just stay afraid.
I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.
A baby? A manger? Huh. Maybe that's it.
Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those whom his favor rests. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those whom his favor rests. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those whom his favor rests.
We should run.
Where? The light is still all around me. I am so afraid, but I'm overjoyed. Yes. Beyond words. The Savior is here. Obadiah, he is here. He is here on our watch. Yes. That's right. Well, why? Why would the angel even choose to tell someone like us at all?
I don't know. And I don't care. Look, what is that? Up in the sky. A star.
Obadiah, after all we've seen tonight, I believe we are supposed to follow that star.
With all of our hearts. To the city of David.
Let's hurry.
Let's run.
Oh, he's here, everyone.
The Savior's here.
Yes,
he's here now.
Oh, wow.
Won the war by a baby boy.
peculiar, but nothing was stuck. We top the story of how these two got together and the path that God chose for them. If it wasn't for his little shafts of light along the way, I don't think they would have made it. It's a great testament to what we've known for years as God's people. That when God has a plan, he provides a way. He provides a way when it seems like there is no way.
Joseph, are you listening?
Mary, I've said it once, I'll say it again, that I can do two things at once.
I know. It's just that I need to tell you something. And Joseph?
Yes?
I need to listen.
Mary, I am listening. I'm listening so hard to you right now, you can't believe how hard I'm listening to you and your words and...
I'm overwhelmed by your concentration. Can you just stop for a second?
Mary, I would love to stop for a second. I can't.
Why not?
We're going to get married soon. I just want everything to be perfect for us.
I love your heart, Joseph. I do. But sometimes things aren't perfect, and that's okay. I mean, who knows what life is going to throw at us, right?
Still, Mary, I want a house worthy of you. And I just got to keep working, because a man...
A man has got to have a plan. I know.
I said that before?
Just a time or two.
Still, Mary, I have so many plans for us. Take this table here. This table is going to be where we have our meals together and spend time together. And I made it big enough for, well, for little ones. For Dollywood, of course.
About that.
Mary, where's my chisel?
Joseph, I need to tell you something. Something unbelievable.
Mm-hmm.
I was visited by an angel. He said I was highly favored.
Is that right? Mary, have you seen my chisel?
And it felt like a dream until he told me something.
It was right here. I just had it.
And as soon as he said it, I knew it to be true.
That's really great, honey. Really.
Joseph, are you listening?
Here. It was in my pocket the whole time.
Joseph!
What?
I'm pregnant.
It is.
rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but he has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers.
Really, how you want to start a marriage. What they were dealing with could really put a strain on not just the relationship, but the engagement. At this point, Joseph told me that he planned to quietly call things off so as not to disgrace Mary. But God called him. God spoke to him. And here we see a new father trying to care for his family. It's amazing how God changes hearts. You see, a baby changes things in a family. Like, Mary told me that her cousin Elizabeth went through a similar thing a few months earlier. It was all part of God's plan. God prepares for what he plans.
What do you mean you can't speak? Put that down, Zachariah. Talk to me. You go to the temple to burn incense, and you come back unable to speak? Because you doubted? What does that even mean? You doubted what an angel told you. Why didn't you say so in the first place? An angel, you say. Are you feeling okay? Maybe you should sit down. I should sit down? I don't have time for this. Whatever game you're playing, Zachariah, it needs to stop right now. It's not funny, Zachariah. An angel told you this. The angel of the Lord told you this. The angel said, our prayers have been heard, and that you, my love, will bear a son?
Oh, that we will be filled with joy and gladness, that many will rejoice at his birth, that he will be like Elijah, who will prepare our people for the Lord? Oh, what are we going to do? I'm too old to be a mother. And you can't even speak. You can't speak until he's born. Well, that might just work for me. I can't wait to tell my cousin Mary. A baby boy, you say. And we will call him Zechariah, yes? John?
How was I supposed to know? If I would have known, I would have given my own bed for the birth of the Savior. But I forgot. You see, 400 years before all of this, our people have been told. There were prophets that told us everything about the coming of Jesus. He was about to fulfill everything. I don't know what his cousin John would say. Probably something about preparation, you know, preparing the way. But I forgot, only to be reminded, because the way had come through my stable, and I almost missed it. True story. When I was 5, I was helping my mother set a table for supper, and I noticed that there was an extra plate. So I said, "Mom, we have an extra plate. Why do we need an extra plate?" And she told me, "You never know who's going to show up." She walked over to me and she says, "You never know who God may bring. You always make room." So we did. Tonight, I did. I made room in my stable and in my heart. While I was making room, God was making a way.
We travel along out of hope and joy, a star in the east, glowing bright in the sky, a yearning within to see the newborn King, a birth foretold and a gift to bring.
Kid was kind of off to the side that was given the innkeeper's part. Kind of shy, but knowing that it was a very, very important role to play in the nativity scene. But unlike normal kinds of times, this little guy just kind of felt like something wasn't right. And even though he didn't want to alter the whole story, he just felt like that there was something deep inside of him that needed a change. And so he didn't know what to do. He knew what he was supposed to do. But as the Mary and Joseph approached the inn, he just couldn't hold it in any longer. And as they tapped on the door, he threw open the door and said, "Come on in, I've been expecting you for a long time." And is it possible that maybe that's what God's message is for us tonight? We know that that's not the way it happened, that there was no room in the inn, the Bible tells us. But is it possible that this is exactly what God was trying to say to each of us? Come on in. I've been expecting you. I've made a way for you. You know, the Bible tells us about the fact that God came at Christmas time. He was the amazing great reach down to earth. And he was down to earth for each one of us. He didn't come as a king that was separated by ropes and you could only see him at a particular time. He came for each one of us, and he came for each of us personally. And the message of Christmas will always be, if you want to see God, if you want to know what God is like, look at Jesus. If you want to know what God is like, take a look into the life of this one they call Jesus of Nazareth. Because he came and he walked this earth. You know, in Hebrews chapter 1, it's a passage in the Bible that says this: "In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets, and many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son." Jesus is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. This is an amazing passage because this little word here, exact representation, it means what it says, but it's more than that. It's like if you wanted to do a statue of a person, it would be the perfect statue. All the detail of the individual would be in that statue. Or if you consider it like a brand, I don't know how many ranchers we have here, but the brand, which is on the metal, is exactly what goes on the hide of the cow. And it is the exact representation. But in a more amazing and thorough and perfect way, Jesus came from heaven to earth, and he is the exact representation of who God is. And so he relates to each one of us. And so if you want to know what God thinks about weddings and storms and stress, you can read God's word about the wedding that Jesus went to. It was the first sort of really awesome thing that he took part in. He turned water into wine, and he had such a great time celebrating with the couple. It was a picture of days to come. If you want to know what he thought about storms and stress, you only have to look into the fact that even Jesus had a few rough days, and he relied on his Heavenly Father. If you want to know what God thinks about strugglers and hypocrites and swindlers, then all you got to do is look at Jesus. And you can see how he related and loved strugglers and hypocrites and a few swindlers. If you want to know what God thinks about a world that seems to be out of control and in many places in our world tonight, things are kind of out of control. They might be out of control in your world tonight too. But Jesus came and said, "That's a world still yet loving for and dying for. And I've come for you." If you want to know what God thinks about death and graves, and all you got to do is look into the life of Jesus, where he went to the memorial of a very good friend, and he wept there. If you want to know what God thinks about graves, consider Jesus, who walked out of his own grave, and who invites us into life eternal as well. And if you want to know what God thinks about you personally, Think of the words that Jesus had in mind for you. For God so loved you that he gave his one and only Son, that if you believe in him, you not perish, but have everlasting life. God comes and he relents. Some of you have noticed that I'm kind of limping tonight. I kind of banged up my knee a couple of weeks ago, and I've got this sort of brace on my knee that doesn't allow me to sort of have free flow, and I've been chauffeured around for the last couple of weeks. It drives me absolutely nuts, as you can imagine. And there's been plenty of things that have had to been done for me. I just can't do everything, and I'm constantly ripping this thing off and on, and you know, it's nothing compared to what some people go through. But man, in the last couple of weeks, has this brace and this little tiny injury ever opened my eyes? I got some friends, I got some people that I know that struggle their whole lives with these kinds of things. And having been there, albeit for a short amount of time, and not nearly what some people go through, but I relate just a little bit. And I think my eyes will never be the same. You know what? In a grander way, Jesus came to our world. He relates. He put on our flesh and blood. He walked the path that we walked. And then, he didn't just stay there. He provided the way to eternal life. Because the Bible tells us that Jesus is the way and the truth and the life. And no one comes on this way except through Jesus. And so tonight is an invitation, if you haven't already done this, to follow him on the way. You say, why do I have to go on Jesus' way? Well, because we're lost until we're on Jesus' way. We may not think of it that way, but the Bible tells us that we're lost until we're on Jesus' way. In fact, we're so lost that we could experience an eternity without him in a little place that the Bible calls hell, if we don't get on his way. And so Jesus comes to us with an open heart and open hand with each of us in mind tonight and says, come on my way. And if you do that, if you say, Jesus, I need you. I know my way has kind of gone all over the place. I know that my way has fallen on some pretty rough times. I need your way, Jesus. It will be a very merry Christmas. That's the way that Christ offers to you tonight. It's personal. And he offers it to you in his way. He has come and he's provided the way that came through that manger. God bless you.
Now I am.
Father, this is your night. Jesus, this is your moment right here and right now. It's a holy night because you came from heaven to earth to make a way. And you did. And you loved us. And God, we're grateful that you come even today in 2016 and touch lives, maybe for the very first time. Thank you, God, that we do not leave this place alone. As we cry out to you and call out to you to guide our path and for us to get on your path and find out where you're going, where you're leading us. So God, thank you that this is a holy night because of your grace and your love come down to each one of us. So God, as we leave this place tonight, we thank you for your goodness. And we ask that you to lead us out into a dark world to spread light. It needs you so much. We thank you, God. Thank you. Have a great rest of the Christmas season. Thanks for being here.